One and all, this is Dr. Saurabh Banerjee on behalf of School of Pharmaceutical Management, IHMR University, Jaipur. I welcome you all for this interesting webinar. So the topic of the webinar today is on market research and what are its application in the pharmaceutical industry. So I feel privileged and honored to welcome the speaker for today, Mr. Pankaj Agarwal ji. Pankaj ji, many, many thanks for accepting our invitation and joining us in this webinar. Kindly allow me to give a brief introduction of Pankaj ji. Pankaj ji is right now working as a Global Brands Insight Manager at Novartis Hyderabad. He is a marketing professional and he has over 10 years of experience in diversified portfolios, varying from marketing insights, consulting, and sales. He has handled many important portfolios of strategic values in various assignments, working with various pharmaceutical organizations. Pankaj ji has been, prior to joining Novartis, he has been also working as a group product manager in Dr. Reddy's Laboratories, and he has also worked at the capacity of group product manager in Alkem Laboratories. And ladies and gentlemen, I take privilege and honor to share with you that Pankaj is an alumnus of IHMR School of Pharmaceutical Management, and he passed out in 2010-12 batch. So, and he has his education qualification prior to in B-Pharm also. Pankaj, many, many thanks once again. Regarding the topic of the webinar today, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to share you that the pharmaceutical industry is a multi-billionaire industry, and the industry is involved in various kind of assignments, right from research and development, manufacturing, distribution of the drugs. The stakes in the pharmaceutical industries are very high. As far as, so whenever you, if you take any case of discovery of new medicine or launching a new particular product in a particular market, the stakes are very high in pharmaceutical market. So in this context, it becomes very imperative that we do a thorough market research in this particular area before we venture into any of the portfolios in the pharmaceutical organization. So good market research is the basic fundamental, and it helps in an informed decision, and it ensures that the risks are, you know, counteracted and you have more success and less of the failure. So we have Pankaj ji, who has a lot of experience in this particular field. So Pankaj, I hand over the dice to you and kindly take us to the journey of market research. We are there to learn from you. Pankaj ji, the dice is yours, please.
Saurabh sir, and good evening all of you. I hope you all can see and hear me.
Yes, so, we can very well hear you.
Yeah. Thank you. So, So topic market research. So first, let me just give a brief about this topic, why I actually chose this particular topic. Why? Because as I was passing out from the IHMR, just like you, many of you are passing out or probably will pass out in the next couple of years. So the thing which I had in mind was which career stream I should choose, whether I should go to a sales profession, whether I should directly jump into a brand management profession or into a KPO, where I should be into consulting or a primary research job or anything of that sort. So, but the key thing is whether I want to aspire for any of these streams, but market research is a key fundamental which you will require in any of these streams, irrespective of wherever you want to go. So that's why I suppose when I'm addressing to you all, this one particular topic will be of interest to all of you. So without wasting any time, I'll quickly share my screen and let you.
Yes, Pankaj, we can yes. See the slide very well. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
So market research and its application in pharmaceutical industry. So particularly market research is a broad subject. So its applications should be understood in the perspective of pharmaceutical industry. So market research has a variety of things involved in it. So what particularly is relevant to our pharmaceutical industry, we are going to talk about this in this session. So for flow of presentation is quite simple. I made it very simple. I tried to. So one is the overall research, market research information. What is the basic definitions? What are the models and techniques that we are using in the practical world? And what are the important pointers you need to consider while conducting or reviewing a market research? Second, not only from the theoretical point of view, since I have some experience, so I would like to share some of the real world case studies, which probably me and my colleagues have done over a period of time in our experiences, so that you can see how in the real world these analysis or these researches are done and then evaluated for the benefit of the informed decision making. So let me just walk you through the research definition. You all will agree it's just the systemic designing, gathering, analyzing, and reporting information that enables you to make educated decisions. That's more, here the two words are most important one. One is systemic. The market research, if it is not systemic, it cannot be successful. It cannot be. And then it has to give any information that should make you enable to have any educated guesses. There, in our world, like Saurabh sir was explaining, there are so many new products are getting launched. There are so many new companies are entering in the market. So, but the problem is launching a new product and launching a new company or launching any product extension for that matter is very, very expensive. So you need to be very, very, very sure whatever you are launching or whatever you are doing has to be foolproof and has to be successful when you are launching. Because if it fails, it is like you are losing a good amount of money and also you are also losing a good amount of opportunity along with it. So the market research actually helps you to take an informed and educated decisions based on those problems. So this is the key part. So a good market research insights plus with those insights, using those insights, if we develop a good marketing strategy, definitely there would be a high probability of the brand getting successful. That's the key mantra. So in our profession, what we always say is, if you have the right insight, big brand idea, BBI, what we normally say is big brand idea. So if you have that idea, your brand will successful in far, far better way than any other brand. But for that real insight, you need to have a real market research conducted prior to this. So this is very, very, very essential. Many of us think probably the marketing strategy plays a good role. Yes, it does. But prior to that marketing strategy development, you need to have a good research to get a good insight about the product or the market or the customers or the disease or any competing molecules, that you can position your brand in a far, far better way than any other particular product present in that area. Okay, so as we all know, the techniques of the market research, there are two types of techniques. One is qualitative, one is quantitative. So I just doesn't want to give you any particular definitions. I just wanted to give you the comparatives of both these techniques. So normally qualitatives and quantitative are the two which are normally in use. So these are the two who are in use most of the time. So what is the main difference and the common scenarios between the qualitative and quantitative techniques? So first of all, the expected output. So when you are conducting a qualitative research, what normally happens is you tend to ask questions which starts with why. Why this happens? Why you are prescribing this product? Why you are going to a doctor? Why what does it mean? What does it mean to prescribe this product? When you are going to a doctor? When you are going to adopt the second line generation product? So all these questions starts with something which actually need, when you need a deeper depth of information particularly. So in that respect, qualitative research actually tends toward those kind of questions. Quantitative, normally we have particular answers or options available with us. So we want to quantify how much that information is quantifiable or can be prioritized. Let's suppose we have four options. So which one is most preferred option? Okay, so how much, how many, who? So these are the type of questions that normally a researcher or a surveyor asked when a qualitative quantitative technique has been in use. the line of questioning, they are open-ended most of the time. And they are all are towards where you will need to answer the question in depth. So that's the fundamental thing about qualitative. Quantitative, they are all close-ended, means how many patients do you see in a day? That's a quantitative question, and that's closed, means you will not ask any other question related to this after that. That's closed. 40 patients a day, that's closed. Okay, so these are all structured, though those can be quantified. That's why they are called as quantitative technique. Sample size, that there it differs a lot. Not many of us normally thinks when you're doing a research, a bigger the sample size, the good amount of result would be there. Because the probability of success, the probability of accuracy of results will be there. But that's not the case. Probably in the qualitative technique, if you have the right sample size, only 8 persons who in the sample would be sufficient. Only 8. But in quantitative, you need to have a bigger sample size pool because you are quantifying the results. So probably when you are quantifying the results, you need to have bigger sample size. So actually quantify it in a big way. Nature, normally, this is the normal practice of any pharmaceutical research. First, you do a qualitative research to analyze and get to the real option which can be developed. Let's suppose I am handling a brand of ophthalmology. So I'm handling a disease area called as dry eye disease, DED. So for that, I'm doing a research. So who all are the practitioners who looks after DED? So I'll develop a questionnaire, open-ended one with qualitative technique that who all are will be handling DED as a condition. So in those open-ended questions, somebody will answer physician, somebody will answer GP, somebody will answer ophthalmologist, somebody will answer IRD specialist. So once I go get those options, so what would be the best chosen options, then I'll quantify those options in the further research. That's the basis of the market research. Once you get the options from the responders, then you quantify them in the following research. That's how it actually happens. Types. Normally, I'll talk about these things later. In-depth interviews are normally the one which happens for getting the good qualitative researches results. Focus group interviews normally called as ad boards also. These are normally the types. Quantitative, normally we all do these kind of techniques in day-to-day life. Paper and pen research where we we prepare a survey, get it verified from our professors and get down in the field to test it. First, then to roll it out to the general population. So that normally is our practice to have a paper and pen interviews. That's the normal procedure. But in COVID times, many of us are not interacting with many of the professionals or the sample pools directly. So telephonic interviews are also happening. So that's also a quantitative technique. Analysis methodologies, these normally qualitative interviews or whatever in ad boards are happening, they will be recorded and then they will be analyzed over a period of time because there are many, many, many more information which comes out. So you need to crisp, jot down every important information after that interview. Normally in quantitative techniques, these are all measurable. So you will jot down in a Excel format and then you will analyze it further. Okay. Examples, normally qualitative is first and the first most important thing that we normally do in qualitative research is patient journey mapping. What is patient journey? If you ask me, patient journey is the most important thing in one of the most important thing for in the brand plans that we normally prepare in our day-to-day life. So patient journey is normally how the patient starts from his onset of symptoms to his diagnosis, to his treatment, and then the follow-up. So it's a journey of the patient from the day he realizes he has a problem, then he approaches a doctor, the doctor diagnoses it, and then he gives him a treatment. If that succeeds, yes, no problem. Then if it does not succeed, he will refer to some other specialist doctor. Then he'll go to that doctor, he will do some other analysis on all that. So I'll explain you in detail. We have a case study regarding this. Patient journeys, and I hope you will like it. Okay, brand positioning. Yeah, it's very, very important to have a right brand positioning for you to succeed. If you have the right brand positioning, your brand will click from the day one. Tactical marketing. You need to, many a times what happens is you developed a messaging or a communication which according to your previous surveys, but that may not be working now. So probably what you'll do is you'll test it or you'll measure it, how that particular messaging is working or not. Like suppose I have a product called as some product A that is efficacious in nature. So I'll test it whether the after the rollout of this message, is it impacting the customers or not? Is it relevant to the customers or not? Probably for the customers, the most important part is safety. So my communication or efficacy will not work there. So I need to, every time I need to test the messaging I need, which I'm rolling out. Emotional research, yeah, it's very, very important. Because many of the patients are, let's suppose in dry eye disease for that matter. In dry eye disease, many of the patients are in the states where they don't want to use a dropper. There are patients who don't want to use spectacles. So we need to consider a consumer behavior in such a way that, yeah, we need to capture that. So for this kind of patient, we need to have this kind of strategy. So all that. Quantitative research, yeah, market sizing. Once I have the segments in place, we all know the STPs, segmenting, targeting, and positioning. So once we have segments in place, like I want to target physicians for this particular indication, then I need to size the market. So which type of physician I need to target? There are 1,800 physicians which I'm going to target, which is probably I'll need to average it out as per my PSR or MR base. So 5 per doctor, that's my aim for this particular strategy. So market sizing all happens with this. Then ATU trials means how your brand is recallable. Many times what happens is your brand gets succeed based on only because of your catchy brand name. Let's suppose I'll give you a good brand example of this, and which is very, very relevant, is one of my previous organization brand name called as PAN, P-A-N. It's one of the biggest brand of the Indian pharmaceutical industry, and it contains pantoprazole. But the brand name PAN, it's so simple and so catchy that nobody would forget this brand after hearing it. That's the power of the brand recall. If you can make it remember to in the customer's mind, your customers will never forget, and you will get regular prescription from them. Segmentation is normally done with this. And all pricing elasticity, you need to test the pricing, whether you are positioning the product, launching the product with the right price or not. Okay, what are the different types of market research models? I'll not emphasize here much because you must all be aware about these techniques. Surveys, we normally do those surveys, pen and paper surveys or telephonic surveys or any kind of surveys in our day-to-day life. Why they are very, very prevalent or very, very much in use? Because they are very cheap. They can be done easily. There is no expense involved in these particular surveys. So these are the most popular ones. Then comes the FGDs, focus group discussions or interviews. Normally these are the ones which are probably most insightful in the nature. Once you get the right questions in place, if you conduct this kind of model research model, you will get the right kind of answers. Ad boards or what we can say is focus other type of focus group discussions. This also this is normally with this smaller pool size where smaller sample size where you get deeper insights with the subjects. Okay, the process normally I highlight these processes in 3 ways. One, if you have the right problem, you'll get the right solution. So first of all, the first process element is the problem. If you can identify the right problem, you can get the right solution. Then second is the right research design. If you want to have something in a quantitative manner and you adopted a qualitative procedure, that's actually research result is not going to work and it's not applicable. It's actually useless. So you need to have the right research design or a right particular technique in the place to make it successful. Then the analysis method. Many analytical tools are available nowadays to analyze the results of that particular research model. Okay, so normally the question comes now then, where these market research models are used. So normally what we say is consumer behavior, okay, to segment the doctors, segment the consumers, or probably for these kind of general things. But here is the big truth that normally the best use of market research actually happens in pre-launch phase of any particular brand. So once you are planning to launch a brand, that's the time when you need to conduct a proper market research. If you are conducting a great market research, then probably you will have the insights which can be used while launching the brand. So the most important phase is the pre-launch phase while you are planning to launch a product. You identified a product. Let me just explain you. I'm working with Novartis now. Will not believe I'm in the research. I'm involved in the research of a brand which is going to be launched in 2026. It's 6 years away. It's not going to launch in 21, 22, 23. It's going to launch in 26. Still, we are doing the research now to make sure that whenever we are launching this product, the product has to hit the right chords. That's the main aim of a market research. But normally, yeah, I need to admit that's normally this kind of environment is there in the organizations where innovation happens or the discovery of the new molecules happens. In most of the MNCs and some of the Indian companies, this is the kind of scene is there. But where the generic companies are there, where the generics are getting launched, normally the launch preparation starts at least a year or at least 8 months before the actual launch of the product. Okay, so in pre-launch phase, which kind of market research that we do is first is disease area landscape. Disease area landscape, what I mean by that is if I am launching a product, particularly in hypertension, so I need to know what hypertension is, which kind of molecules that we are that are in use for hypertension, which kind of specialties that are getting involved in the hypertension, what is the prevalence and incidence rate of hypertension in the country, what kind of patients are there, what kind of side effects, what are the need and gaps analysis, all those things has to be done for this particular disease area. I need to have in-depth analysis of this disease which I'm entering into. So probably I'm launching a losartan molecule for hypertension. I need to know everything about the disease first. Then after about the molecule, then after the accompanying molecules and the patients, the consumers and the customers who are going to use it. Portfolio planning. Okay, sometimes what happens is, I was handling Taximo at particular point of time while I was working for LKM laboratory. So for Taximo, it's a big brand, 220 crore brand, one of the largest brand of the Indian pharmaceutical industry. So for that, these kind of products, you need to make sure that these products should survive and should grow even after the bigger the size that they have. It's most important that 200 crore brand should grow by the same kind of growth that IPM is growing so that you can maintain your number one or number two ranks in the coming years to come as well. So for that, you need to plan in such a way that your marketing strategy are right on the note. Brand STP development. Yes, before the launch, you need to segment the customers with the right notes, then target them, then position the product accordingly. In the launch, you need to, while launching the product, launching planning, you need to do market research for tracking whether the launch particular strategy is working or not. Patient journey, I'll explain you in the coming slides about it. Brand communication, it's very important to test the communication, to develop the communication in line with the market research findings. Okay, after the launch, when the product is already available, you need to track the performance. Tracking the performance can be done through secondary or primary research while using the external data or internal data points. Lifecycle management, probably in what happens normally is like Bisleri for that matter. They have their brand available for so long. So few years back to make it sustainable in the market and to grow it further, what they did is they launched Bisleri 500. It's a new category of 500 ml bottled water, which nobody has ever thought of because they are the market leader. They will define the market. They will make the market grow that particular category. So that's what comes under the life cycle management. Competitive strategy. You need to be very, very aware about these competitive strategy. Which products are going to hit you hard? What are their communications? What are their campaigns? What are their attributes? What they are going to do in the market, what kind of strengths they have, what kind of positioning they have, so that you can position your product accordingly in order to succeed. Market event preparation and everything. Okay. So just a few pointers, which probably in market research, you need to consider while preparing a questionnaire, because this is where most of the market researchers are, even me, when I was preparing a market research questionnaire, actually have gone wrong. So first is we need to have simple words. It's not your vocabulary test where you need to have heavy jargons or slangs or particular high-end vocabulary words. No, you need to use the words which are very, very familiar, very, very easy, very and understandable from to the audience. So then only your audience or the responder can reciprocate to you in form of an answer. You need to be specific and precise. The less words you are using for a market research, the better for you. It is better for you always. It should not be non-leading. Means you should not ask a question which particularly directing the responder in such a way. You should be open to all type of answers that the responder or the answerer is giving to you. Concise, yes. You need to use very, very straightforward language. You all direct and short languages, read them. You need to make a question in such a way that they can read it very, very quickly. If the questionnaire is cumbersome to read, probably it will take time. So the probability is he is not going to read it and he is not going to answer it in proper way. Consistent. Whatever your research objective is, you need to consistent in that way to get the right answers, problem solving answers for you. And then define abbreviations. If at all you are using some abbreviations, like I used FGDs here, focus group discussions. So in the end of the questionnaire or in the bracket of the those abbreviations, always define those abbreviations. So that, because FGDs for me, it's a normal thing, but for many of you, it may not be. So always define abbreviations while you are preparing a questionnaire. Okay, sample size. This is one of the important aspects while doing a market research. So as I told you earlier, for quantitative research, you need to, the number of responders has to be high in the numbers. It always depend on the type of research, research problem that you have. So it may vary from 50 to 150, but in qualitative, the research sample pool can be as low as 8 also. That 8 pool, why I'm saying 8 is sufficient because it is all research and well studied, that if you have right people in your research pool, sample pool, then only 8% can give you the right information which you want for the problem solution of your problem. Okay, so let me just straightforward jump to the case study number one. Okay, these are all real world case studies which I or my colleague has done in their career span. So these are different type of problems from different type of disease areas, and I've taken I tried to simplify them from my end. So in the question answer session, if you want to understand more about these case studies, how they have been designed and how they have been used for the implications after using them, so you can ask the questions accordingly. So first of the case study is about the attribute analysis. Now, attribute normally are associated with a brand. Let me give an example. When I think of Apple, I think of kind of masterclass, innovative product, best in class, perfect in design, perfect in use, easy to use, fluent in nature, and top brand quality, probably. These are the kind of attributes which I think of the brand when of a phone when I'm using Apple phone particularly. But it may not be the case with Xiaomi or any other brand, with no offense. But these are the kind of attributes which actually are associated with Apple. So there are always certain kind of attributes which are associated with some brands. So you need to identify which attributes are most important for the customers, and on those attributes, how your brand is faring. That's the most important thing. So let's suppose, here the research objective in the real world was, so we wanted to understand, we had a great product in our company, so which was doing well, and we wanted to further analyze how we can further make this product grow, how we can compete against the fiercely competitive market which was there, because it was antihistamines, as you all know, it's a overcrowded product, overcrowded market where there are so many competitors available. Probably every now and then when a new company is launching, they will first launch an antihistamine kind of product, a cetirizine, a levocetirizine kind of product, first of all. So it is important that if we are the leader, we should define our attributes in such a way that customer should prescribe our product in the first place. So in this particular market research, our objective was to understand the top desired attributes for top molecules. What are the top attributes which are desired by a doctor? What the doctor wants? Does he want safety or efficacy? Or does he want something else? What does he want? First, let us understand them. Then on those parameters, how our brand is faring, or how a competitive brand is faring. So I can analyze then which are the points which I should work upon, or which are the strengthening points which I can use against my competitor. So I'll straight away jump into the analysis that we have done. Okay, so there are multiple questionnaires given to them. So like I told you before, what we did normally is in this particular format, we did a qualitative research with an in-depth questionnaire. Okay, with an open-ended in-depth questionnaires, we did a research and we got an option. So we ask questions like, what is that one thing that you need in a product, anti-histaminic product? So some said less sedation, it should not create any sedation. There should not be any drowsiness feeling. It should act fast, rapid onset of action. Some said, okay, if I'm taking medicine today morning, it should act till tomorrow morning. Okay, so these are the answers that they have given. And based on that, then we then did a quantitative research. So once we got a variety of options, so we took the most probable options and we then quantified it. So after quantification, we got to know that less sedation is the most desirable attribute. So when I am a doctor and I think of an antihistamine product, I think that it should not create any drowsiness feeling for my patient. Then the second part comes is it should have a rapid onset of action. So the efficacy probably for all products may be same, but if your product is acting fast or any of the of your brand character by which the product is acting fast, probably in 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever, he is looking at those kind of attributes in your brand. If your brand is acting fast, he will definitely prescribe your brand. Okay, so these are the kind of attributes which came out in this study for antihistamine as a category. This is not about the brand. This is about the category, antihistamine category. Antihistamine category has a variety of molecules. So then we try to understand that on each of these attributes, how every molecule, there are four top molecules in this particular category. One is levocetirizine, cetirizine, fexofenadine, and hydroxyzine. So these are the top molecules which are in use for antihistamine. So we want to then evaluate which of the how the different type of molecules are faring in these attributes. So as you can see right here, I suppose all you can see and understand. So this is the attribute. So these are all the attributes, and this is the scale from 1 to 5. So 0 is the least important. Means if your attribute is considered 0, then it would be least importance to them. And if it is scaled as 5, then that would be the most important attribute for the doctor. So in that scale, you can see, here. So here you can see the levocetirizine, which is represented in the yellow dots, is faring far, far better than any of the other molecules. What it means for you? What it means is a doctor, when he thinks of prescribing any antihistamine brand, he first will think about prescribing levocetirizine brand. Levocetirizine brand. I'm not saying particular brand, but I'm saying any levocetirizine brand. He will first try to prescribe levocetirizine, not cetirizine, not hydroxyzine, not fexofenadine, because in his particular choice of molecules on and about those desirable things that he wants to have for a molecule, levocetirizine is faring far, far better than any other molecule. So levocetirizine is the drug of choice for him when he wants to treat any patient with antihistamines. Okay, then comes, okay, these are the molecules. Then the next question comes, what are the top desired brand attributes? Now you'll ask me a question, how the brand attributes are different from a molecule attribute. So normally what happens is a molecule is always generic in nature, which is present in always all the other brands. So there are 100 types of levocetirizine brands available in the market. But how I am different than that brand, all the other 99 brands that actually create my attribute. So as you can see how it is different. You in the previous presentation, as you can see, the less drowsiness, the less sedation was the primum important particular factor for this kind of product. But when it comes to a brand, rapid onset of action is the most important thing that they want to have in a brand. Plus, rapid action plus sustainable action for at least 24 hours. I do not want to have a product which I need to take for 2 times a day. For OD, I need to have a product which I need to take OD. That it means is that I don't want a product which needs to be taken BD or TID doses for. So long-term therapy. So long-term therapy is the first priority. But as a marketer, I suppose we all choose the top ones. So only top 2 or 3 are considered as an attribute to define a marketing strategy or define a communication. So for me, the most important brand attribute to have is rapid onset of action. If my brand is getting in notice in terms of my brand is rapidly acting on the disease and what sustainable action is there for the next 24 hours, probably my brand would be the best brand for the doctors to treat. And on these brand attributes, how the top brands are getting fared. As you can see here, here are the top brands in the levocetirizine market, where you can see in some of the attributes, some of the top attributes, levocet is faring far, far better than any other brand and closely competing with Zyzel. So, but as you will see in the next 3 categories here, Zyzel is faring far better than levocet. But that does not make Zyzel as a number one brand choice. Why? Because for the doctor, these are the 2 or 3 best parameters or best attributes to have in a brand. If I am not scoring well compared to my competitors on these particular parameters, probably I'm not going to overcome those competitive problems. So if I need to compete in this market, probably the so what are the take-home messages for if I'm let's suppose a levocet brand manager, what is the take-home message for me? The take-home message for me is, yes, keep on harping on your strength, which is rapid onset of action and 24-hour symptom control. So keep your messaging straight and so show the scientific communication in such a way that demonstrate the product availability or the brand availability that you are rapidly acting and sustainable, giving sustainable results. So this is the take home for levocet. If I'm a Zyzel brand manager, so what I'll think is in my area where I'm strong, levocet is equally or probably a better in the market. So what I need to do is I need to devise a strategy where I can be better than levocet in rapid onset of action and 24-hour symptom control. So what I'll do in my visual detailing or in my communication strategies, I'll pick out those pointers in the visual detailing, which demonstrates that Zyzel actually is compared to levocet is doing better in terms of rapid onset of action or 24-hour symptom control. So that's the take-home message for Zyzel. If I'm Taxine, so for Taxine brand manager, what he will think? He will think I cannot compete against these 2 brands, levocet and Zyzel. These are the 2 superstars in the first 2 categories, which are the most perceived and most desired attributes by the physicians. So what I can do, I can harp upon my strength, which is long-term therapy. So if I am perceived good in some of the areas, I should harp upon this rather than going against these top brands, which are already far, far better than me in sales, in strength of the company, and in terms of attributes. So I'll not be able to compete in those segments where these two brands are faring far, far better than me. So I'll compete and create my own niche. And that niche may be long-term therapy, which is third most desirable attribute by a doctor. So these are how a different type of brand communications are developed based on the results of a market research. So these are different takeaways which you can take based on which kind of brand you are handling. So that's the research number one, where you are trying to evaluate what are the top attributes that the doctor want, and on those top attributes, how I'm faring and versus the competition. So that's the research number one. That's the most basic research that we normally do to test our messaging strategy, to test our communications, to even sometimes what we do is we roll out our brand plans in April for the new year. Then we test these out after 6 months in September or so, how good this brand messaging is working or not in favor of a brand compared to our competitors. So what we'll do is normally before the brand plan, we'll do this kind of survey, which will show us this kind of result. And after the survey, then we will develop our communications. So after 6 months of consistent communications, then we will evaluate it further, whether my attribute in terms of rapid onset of action is same, or has it increased or decreased. That's how I'll do my evaluation. So these kind of attribute analysis can be used for the present scenario and for the follow-up scenarios to evaluate my performance of the brand. Okay, case study number two. Here, it is for a different kind of product in the gastro segment. It is also a real-world case study where a top brand actually is fighting to grab share from other molecule. So in gastro space, there are four molecules which actually competes in a big way. One is omeprazole, one is ranitidine, one is pantoprazole, and one is rabeprazole. These are normally the top four molecules which are there in the market, which has maximum market share in this gastro PPI and antihistaminic S2A receptor blocker space. So these are the four top molecules are in use. So one of the top brands of a particular molecule wants to know why ranitidine is the top selling molecule, and how I can beat this particular ranitidine market, how can I capture this market share from ranitidine. So they want to understand that. So for that, they have conducted one study and market research in this way. So they want to reposition their product to evaluate a way where they can capture the market share of ranitidine, because ranitidine has a market share of approximately 33% of overall this PPI plus this anti-acid segment. So how I can convert those ranitidine prescribers to omeprazole or rabeprazole or a pantoprazole prescriber. What was the situation when they want to conduct this research? I just want to give you a background on this part. So normally what happens is ranitidine is the most considered as the most cost effective molecule compared to rabeprazole, omeprazole or pantoprazole, which are compared to ranitidine. When ranitidine is normally a 1 rupee or 2 rupee product compared to omeprazole, which is 3 rupees back, or 5 rupees, pantoprazole, 7 rupees, 10 rupees, sometimes 15 rupees as well. So these are all the other three molecules are very, very costly compared to ranitidine. So, but cost is not always the only factor which drives your market share. That's not the true part. If it is going to be true, then probably Apple would have not been the kind of market share that they have right now. If it would be the probably any other smartphone player which is cheaper in price, but they are not. The number one market player, despite having the least number of models, Apple is the number one player in this market. So what they were trying to do is, because of NELEM, that's the authority, because of which the price are controlled. So what happened at that point of time when this research was planned is, omeprazole came under NELEM DPCO, and the its price got reduced to 2.5 from, let's suppose, 5 rupees. So its price was reduced by 50%. So now their gap between ranitidine price and omeprazole price was far, far less compared to what was the situation earlier. So since my price is half, so automatically my revenue will loss. If I'm a 50 crore brand, my revenue in an instant will come down to 25 crore. So I will be looking at a 25 crore loss, which for a corporate is not a good situation. So for that, what I can do? So for that, what they identified is, okay, now ranitidine is a big market. There they have 33% market share. So how I can convert these ranitidine prescribers to my prescribers? What can be the strategy that I can use? Okay, so to compensate the gap, of course, of this 25 crore, plus to grow the market further. So for that, they have this objective of understanding why ranitidine is being prescribed, what are the different attributes of ranitidine versus omeprazole, what are the different proportions, who is prescribing, with what products they are prescribing, because normally the PPIs are prescribed as a co-prescription, not as a standalone prescription. So with what kind of molecules are omeprazole or rabeprazole or pantoprazole or ranitidine is getting prescribed, in what kind of patients, in what kind of product, with what kind of products, what kind of doctors are prescribing this kind of product. So for that, they launched a questionnaire to get an insight. So first, qualitative research was conducted. After that, a quantitative research was conducted. So it was conducted through a questionnaire with GPs and CPs, because these are the two main users of PPIs or ranitidine. So what was the result? So yeah, here you can see, these are three two particular categories, GPs and CPs, as you can see here. So this is as a co-prescription therapy. So let's suppose if I'm using ranitidine, when I'm using omeprazole. So for GP, he's using ranitidine or omeprazole or any other PPI when he's prescribing what antibiotics and anesthetics both. So normally what happens is, as a side effect of antibiotics and anesthetics, normally there is excess acidity problem. This is normally considered as a side effect of any NSAID or antibiotic. So as a preventive measure, normally what happens is, doctor always prescribes a PPI brand or an ranitidine brand along with any antibiotic or NSAID normally. So general practitioners normally prescribing any of these PPIs when they are prescribing antibiotics and NSAIDs in combination. And there is quite a big share where they are prescribing any NSAID for any pain relief, let's suppose for joint pain relief, let's suppose for any headaches or for any chronic use where the chance of acidity is far, far high. There they are using any of these PPIs for that matter. And same is the case with consulting physician. So with this research, we can understand that which are the most used case for any PPIs or any ranitidine. Here you can understand, in 1/3 of the cases, normally PPIs are prescribed along with an NSAID alone. So a patient is coming to me with a problem of some joint pain or any bone pain or any chronic pain, and I'm prescribing him a dose of NSAID for long-term use. So there the probability of having this acidity problem is very, very high. In those cases, he's always prescribing a PPI or ranitidine brand along with it. So remember this findings. Now, when he's prescribing this kind of PPI, so we have separated the patient pools into two subsets. One who has prior gastric issues, one who do not have any gastric issues previous to this pain or any kind of problem. So one patient pool is who is someone who is coming with prior gastric problems. He may be suffering with any gastric problems in advance before suffering with this problem. But there is a patient pool second also where there is no gastric issue at all. So here you can see the results are very, very shocking to all of us that when there is no prior gastric issue problems, the ability or the probability of prescribing grandidine is far, far higher than prescribing any other molecule. You can see it here. Approximately 44% share is going to grandidine when they don't have any issue, when they don't have any prior gastric issues. But the probability, if I have any gastric issues and I'm going to prescribe any NSAID, my probability of grandidine getting prescribed is very, very low. Almost 1/4 to this condition. Same is the case in all the old age patients. Similar is the case in this case. So what I actually am wondering here is, if I don't have any problem of gastric related problem, then I'll definitely prescribe, my chance of prescription would be for grandidine. But if I do have any problem, gastric problem, I'll not try to use grandidine. I'll use some other brand which is of PPI category, omeprazole or aripiprazole or pantoprazole. So what it means, it may mean that I'm using grandidine for the preventive measure, that I'm prescribing antibiotic or NSAID. So it should, if it creates any acidity related problems, then I'm prescribing you this grandidine, Acilock or Xander, so that your acidity problems can be taken care of. But if I'm already suffering with acidity, my doctor's probability of writing grandidine is far, far, far less than I'm writing omeprazole brand or aripiprazole brand. That's the finding, and that's very, very shocking. Now, on third parameter, so how I'm faring better than this grandidine molecule? So there was an attribute analysis being done of omeprazole versus grandidine. Here you can see all the efficacy parameters, whether good clinical experience, long lasting effect, higher efficacy, or faster onset of action. These are all efficacy parameters. These are all efficacy parameters where omeprazole is faring far, far better than grandidine. But when it comes to cost or as a preventive therapy, you can see here, grandidine is scoring far better than omeprazole. So it's very, very clear now what we need to do. So how, what is the take home message for me? What is the positioning strategy for me to, or communication strategy for me after this research? So what I'll do, so now I'll product, if my product is product O, I'll reposition it in such a way that it can be perceived as an efficacious brand, a brand which can be used for preventive use as a co-prescription with NSAID. That's it. That's the crux of this particular research. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to compare my brand against grandidine and prove it as a most efficacious brand, which can be used as a preventive therapy along with the NSAID prescriptions. That's it. So that's how I'll I'll do my campaigns, I'm messaging, my visual aids, everything will be in this line. So once I do a proper research and this kind of findings are there, probably this will take your brand to the next level. And the result, I'm happy to share that after doing research and applying all these research findings, the brand, particular brand O, has grown by 34% in that next year. So this is the power of doing the right marketing research. If you have the right marketing research models with you, if you can analyze the results in a better way, you will get the right findings, and you, if you apply them, your brand will do wonders. Okay, so this is case study number two. Now the case study number three, and probably the most difficult one, here the most complex case study is there, where you need to develop an understanding about the patient journey. Patient journey, of an osteoarthritis patients. Osteoarthritis is not a uncommon problem in our society. It happens to almost everyone probably post age 40. It can happen before 40 years of age, but normally it happens after 40 or 50 years of age. It's an old age problem normally considered. So what the research team wants to do or understand is, they want to understand how my patient is moving from the onset of action, onset of symptoms, then how he's getting diagnosed, how he's getting treated, how he's getting followed, whether he's satisfied with the options or not, and what are the need and gaps of this particular problem. So here is the objectives. So we want to know the patient journey of a particular osteoarthritis, osteoporosis patients. This particular patient journey, you will not find it in any other industry. Patient journey is normally done in the pharmaceutical industry to know the behavior and the journey of the patient, so that we can leverage any point and we can intervene and we can get succeed. Here, we want to broadly identify the treatment and management dynamics of osteoporosis among physicians and orthopedicians. And we want to understand what are the key important factors for a patient or a doctor to consider your product. Okay, so this is a qualitative research. As I told you, there the sample size needs not to be big. Here, the in-depth interviews has been conducted across the cities. So we have carefully designed a survey where we take different kind of doctors, different specialty doctors from different geographies, so that we can get the sense for overall population. So what is happening in the general population? So in the round one, we conducted interviews with the doctors, and the round two, we conducted interviews with the patients, how they are feeling, how they are, whether they are satisfied with the particular treatment option or not. So this is what the methodology is all about. So normally what we do is we conduct an in-depth interview with the doctors, and then we conduct the in-depth interviews with the patients. But here is a caution. Normally, by law, we marketers cannot contact or communicate with the patients directly. It's not permissible. We can contact the doctors, we can take their interviews, but we cannot take interviews of the patients. We cannot take, we cannot interact with them, we cannot take any feedbacks from them. So for any patient information or for any patient interviews, we then have to have a consulting agency, a research agency, which in turn will then develop this kind of questionnaires and will conduct a research for the patient's journey. So that's how it happens. So normally, doctors interviews can be done by the company and the medical department, but the research can be done only by the external agency. Companies cannot be involved in that. Only they can observe the interviews. They cannot interfere with the interviews. That's by law is happening. So once in, I suppose it is clear for all of us. Okay, so how it looks like then after research, how a patient journey looks like. So normally, as you can see here, the patient journey has four steps. One is the presentation of the symptoms or the onset of the symptoms or the signs. Then comes the diagnosis, then comes the treatment, and then comes the fulfillment, whether he is happy with the treatment or not. And then comes different stages, different stakeholders who are involved in this process. One is patient, of course. One is family physician or a GP. It may be GP, it may be consulting physician. And one then orthopedician or a dermatologist. In many of the case studies, it may happen that chemist is also a part of it, because where there is a good component and push factor involved in the product, there chemist can also be a stakeholder in this journey. But here it is not important, so we have not included this. So how the patient journey looks like? This is how it looks like. So in the step one, what happens is a patient feels a low back pain or a knee pain or any kind of pain in the legs. So normally they wait for 1 to 3 weeks, then they approach a family physician. So normally for a normal patient, they will not directly go to an orthopedician. once first they will try to contact the nearby physician which is available, whether it may be a GP, it may be a consulting physician. So they will try to contact them. So first they will run some blood tests and stuff like that. Then they will prescribe some general medication which are available, like calcium supplements, any calcium carbonate or calcium citrate or vitamin D or any painkillers to relieve them from that pain. But what happens is, if it is an osteoporosis problem, it cannot be relieved with these kind of supplements. Then what happens is he will go back and forth complaining about the problem. He will go once again to the GP or a particular physician. Then when he will not be satisfied with the results, then he will approach an orthopedician, a specialist in that particular category. So here the pain would be worsened. Here the issues would be with the walking. He cannot walk, he cannot sit properly, he cannot sleep properly. He has to take these pills on a daily basis for the relieving from the pain. Then what he does is, he does multiple other tests as well. Based on that, he prescribes some pharmacological option. Like here in this case, bisphosphonates, which are normally in use. And these bisphosphonates normally are available in oral form as well as in injectable form. Then they will try these kind of products. Then if they are not satisfied, if the symptoms are still persisting, then the patient goes back to the orthopedician and they will think of some other therapy available. So here how the journey of the patient looks like. So why this patient journey is important for us? So because we can understand from this patient journey, what are the leverage points, what are the pain points of these patients. So here you can understand, here you can see the stars. Yeah, these stars actually are the leverage points for the brands that I'm talking about. So if I am introducing a new therapy, so what I'll do is, patient is getting treated with some primary medications in oral form medication, but he is not getting relieved even after 1-2 years of use. So these dissatisfied patients actually are my key target maker. These are the target population I should target. So with patient journey, my STPs, segmenting, targeting and positioning can be easily identified. So this is the patient pool. So what would be my patient pool to target? My patient pool would be targeted would be, then it is as a second line product, which cannot be satisfied with the first line therapies like bisphosphonates and are looking for some other solutions to treat their osteoporosis. This is my leverage point. If I target specifically this patient point, patient pool, my chance of success would be way, way higher than any other thing. So this is how a patient journey looks like. If you get the right patient journey, if you get the right leverage points, your chance of success would be very, very high. But caution to you, my friends, it's not very easy to develop a patient journey. You need at least, I suppose, in normal scenario, you need at least 1 to 2 months to develop a patient journey like this. It's not very easy. You need to be very, very precise about how the patient journey looks like, who are the stakeholders involved, what kind of patient pool you should choose. As you can see here, we have tried to take the patients from across geographies, from Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, Kolkata, so that we can have perspective from east, north, west, south. Similarly with the doctors, we tried to take different specialty doctors from different type of geographies, so that we can have a patient journey which is universal in nature. That's very, very important. If your sample size is not like where it is not representing the universe, it is of no use. The result would not be of any use if your sample size and the sample type of sampling that you are doing is not representing the universe. So you need to be very, very, very precise about the sample size. Then only you can get the right result. So this is how a patient journey looks like. And it's very, very important to get it right. Because after a patient journey, then you can get the live leverage points like this. So if I'll not develop this kind of patient journey, if I'll go blindfolded, like I'll target every osteoporosis patients for a new upcoming research-oriented expensive product. So in this case, I forgot to tell you, this product actually is a research-oriented product, which has been, we collaborated with one of the international MNCs to get this product in India. So compared to all the other available options, this is far, far more expensive, probably 20 times more expensive than the available options. So then if it is 20 times more expensive, of course, you can understand it cannot be given or it cannot be affordable for every one of them. So we need to identify which are the patients which are right patients for this, which are the patients who are in need of this kind of treatment. So that's why we need to develop a patient journey like this to understand the leverage points and to identify the right patient segments where we can target and get the proper success of this. So, okay, so similar kind of journey has been developed for the severe patients. Here, the normally what happens is here, you can see a bit of difference in the timelines. Normally, a moderate or a mild osteoporosis patient will take years to reach to a orthopedician. But when the problem gets severe, they will not take years. If my pain is here, if I cannot walk, I cannot sleep, I cannot do anything properly, then probably my probability of reaching to an orthopedician, the timelines will be very, very fast. In this case, I will approach an orthopedician probably directly or within 2-3 months time frame, compared to in moderate or a mild case scenario where the patient will take at least 1 to 2 years to reach to an orthopedician. So these all things we need to take into consideration while developing the right patient segment to target and the right communication strategy. If we are talking like this is the first if we develop the communication lines like this for this expensive therapy for all osteoporosis patients, probably the doctor is not going to listen to you. He will say, "Rob, boss, you don't teach me. This is so expensive. All of my patients cannot afford it." So then I need to reevaluate my positioning accordingly. If sir, then my positioning should be like this. If your patients are not getting satisfied with the available options after giving it for sufficient duration of time, 1-2 years, if in 1-2 years cannot give you satisfied results, then probably you should look for something better option, which can be affordable by some group of patients, and those are the patients you should target. So your communication strategies, your campaigns have to be in line with this kind of leverage points. Okay. So then you will identify which are the most important unmet needs of this particular patient group or a particular doctor, so that you can position your product accordingly. So this is all part of a market research. If your market research is good enough, probably your findings would be good and you'll get the right leverage points or the unmet needs where you can position your product. So this is all from my side. I suppose I've taken what approximately 1 hour of your time, but I tried to be as simple and understandable as I can. So over to you, Saurabh sir, if anyone has any questions to ask or anything.
Yes, Pankaj, it was an excellent delivery. And you very well, in a very lucid way, covered all the particular points which are very relevant for market research. And I'm very sure the objective of this webinar was to enlighten the people about the market research, positioning, product and brand management. And you very, in a very lucid and a very simple and very subtle way, explained all the things. And the case study, they are very, the people who are listening to this webinar, they are very fortunate that you brought your, lot of experience to share this thing with this particular case studies. And I'm very sure, these kind of case studies will help them in their near future. Thank you so much, Pankaj. Pankaj, we can take, a bit of questions also. Right. Let me just go through some of the questions which have been shared with the participants. There is a question that I am a pharmaceutical management student and as a fresher, how can I get into the market research? Pankaj, would you like to answer this question?
Okay. So getting into market research, probably there are many companies like KPOs, particularly like IQVIA, companies where I'm working in Novartis, and EBS Global Data. There are many companies, particularly KPOs, where the PMR teams are there. Those are called as PMR teams, primary market research teams. Then and they have a lot of opportunities and a lot of requirements of any upcoming talent. So for getting into this kind of thing, you need to be first have two kind of skills. One is you need to be very, very good in your written communication, probably. Because designing questionnaire is one of the key part of becoming a successful market researcher. Plus, your analytical capability has to be very, very good. If you can produce a result, your research design is good, your questionnaires are good, you did it in the right way, but you cannot analyze the results which are coming out, probably the entire market research proposition is a waste of time. So these two skills, I suppose, if you can acquire and strengthen, probably there are a lot of companies who are up there to take you up in the companies.
Thank you. Thank you, Pankaj. Let's move on forward. There is a, again, similar to this question is that how to enter in this field for a fresher student? How to enter for a fresher if he's, somebody is interested in market research? Yes, Pankaj.
Yes, so I think there is no particular answer to this, but I would rather say look towards your senior who are already working in this profession.
Right.
Get in touch with them and try to be as productive as possible and try to acquire these kind of skills which are required in this particular field.
Right.
A fresher is not a problem in this particular situation because in this particular field, all fresh talents, normally what I've seen is all the fresh talents are invited.
Right.
I would say, I have experience in sales, market research, this inciting and marketing in three domains. So with my experience, I can say only the marketing is the domain where the probability of having experiences is plus, but apart from that, in the market research or market inciting domain or a KPO domain, it's not like where you cannot enter in this kind of field. You can, if you have the right kind of skills.
Right. Let's move forward. There is one question. For a market research fresh intern, what are the skills one must have? And what is the process or the tips to develop these skills? Are there any courses required? Pankaj?
I suppose part of it I already answered.
Yes.
One is, I'll again repeat it. So one is written communication. You need to be very, very good in written communication because of the things that I've shared. Like the simplicity in the wordings, the designing of the questionnaire, those are most important things while doing a research, preparing for a research. Then after that, analytical capability. If you can't analyze the results, because what you will get is probably many a times you have to go through tons and tons amount of data. You'll be lost in the PPTs and the Excels that these market research will produce. So you need to go through all of them and need to be very, very good in analyzing, okay, this is the kind of result I'm getting. So you need to mix and match many many findings and then arrive at a point, okay, this is the combination of research finding which is useful to me. Like I shared in the omeprazole versus ranitidine case, there are the three different types of data points were there. Now I need to mix and match, okay, what is the take-home message for me? That's where my analytical capability comes in the place.
Correct. There is one more question that please tell about some methods for improving the responses rate in getting the responses from the physicians.
Okay, that's a good question. I missed that part. So probably a good market research will always pilot the survey first, or whatever he is doing. So what I normally tend to do is whenever I'm designing a survey or a interview questionnaire or anything, I'll test it or pilot it with my known ones or the experts in my company or who I know once. I mean, sir, when I was in marketing, so I used to test it with the top KOLs of the country. I have contacts with the top KOLs who has kind of enormous amount of experience and are respected well in this particular fraternity. So I used to go to them and ask them, sir, I'm going to conduct this kind of market research and I have these questions with me. So please have a look at them, whether they are making sense or whether they are the appropriate questions where to get my to solve my problem. So then they will advise me. So in my case, it is KOLs or my peers or my superiors. Mm-hmm. You can choose any of your professors or your seniors or your alumni to test it out, whether the kind of questionnaires that you are designing are good to get the results that you want to get. So many times what happens is I'm designing a questionnaire in my own way. So many things I'll miss out. So I may not be able to look from the responder's point of view. Many times it happens. It happens with all the experts, all the experienced professionals as well. So it is good to pilot or test it first to get it right in the first case.
Great, Pankaj. Pankaj, this is in context to the case number. There is a question that in the third case study, they surveyed a lot of doctors, but why the gynecologists were interviewed? I mean, they were not relevant with the market research about the ortho patient. So,
okay. Since there was a time constraint, so I did not explain that. So for ortho, osteoartho, for this kind of problem, actually, why gynecologists are involved is all postmenopausal patient group is on high risk for osteoporosis.
Right.
All 45 plus, because there what happens is the hormonal particular hormones like estrogen and progesterone, they kind of stops. So because of that, there is a lack of calcium absorption in the body and a chance of developing osteoporosis. So they are at high risk of osteoporosis. So a gynecologist many a times is the first point of contact for many ladies who has this problem. Then from gynecologist, they refer it to a rheumatologist or a orthopedician.
Right. Thank you so much. There is a very good question that what questions are generally expected in the interviews by the recruiter for market research interns? What questions are expected by the interviews? There is a broad.
I'll say two things here. Means there are once you are good in the subjects, I suppose the questions that are going to be there are of no. They are easy for you. So the process normally, which I understand for these market research companies which are hiring, is they give you a case study normally, most of the time. They will give you a case study and they will ask you to present it or ask you to summarize it in front of a panel.
Right.
So what they will do is they will hand you over a case study which you need to solve. I don't know the particular process, but I'm just giving you a glance of what normally a company does. So you need to solve those case studies. So for solving a real practical world a case study, you need to be thorough about the marketing principles, which kind of questionnaires you need to build, what kind of methodology or kind of technique you need to have, what is the sample size, what are the sources you need to look at. And then after having all this, how you are going to analyze those results. So what are the tools you are going to use? In nowadays, we have so many of technology tools available to us for analyzing the results. So you need to be aware about all of them. So many a times a company does that. So I suppose there is no single answer to that, but I'm sure once you will be thorough to all the basic understanding about market research, it would be easy to crack.
Correct. You know, in short, what I understood, you know, the organizations mainly need the person good writing skills, good communication skills, and good analytical skills. These are the three very important. And these kind of consulting firms, what they have a very tough process for selection process. And there are a lot of aptitude tests, reasoning, mental ability. You need to be very good in cracking, because if you can't crack these steps, you cannot get into the case study, and that is a later part. But first, you have to be very good in cracking the aptitude, mental reasoning. Then a lot of data interpretation questions are being asked. So I would advise the people who are listening to the webinar, so prepare yourself very well in these aspects, and then case study, as Pankaj discussed, you have a lot of case studies are on the web. You can discuss a lot of case studies. These three case studies, they are the best case studies. You can go into the depth of this particular case studies. This would help you a lot. Pankaj, I think the people were so much they were listening to you so enthusiastically, and they understood the things so well that they have around, we have 35 questions. That is a indication that they got the things pretty well, so I'm very happy that the people are asking the questions, and we are helping them to. So I will just go through the last one or two questions. Hello sir, what kind of career growth will be there if someone chooses pharmaceutical market research as a main career? Pankaj.
Okay. What kind of career growth? I suppose there are no limitations.
Yes.
There is always. So let me tell you this. With the COVID situation, I can tell you this, the market research importance or the inciting importance would be much, much higher than the earlier days. Why I am telling you this? Because in the COVID post-COVID new normal scenario, what will happen is these smaller companies will not be able to survive because of many innovations which are going to come. Now, yesterday I was reading one report from one of the respected agencies for data, SMSRC, in India, Indian perspective. So what they have said is many doctors are shifting from physical consultation to digital consultation, which we all can observe.
Right.
But
right,
this
right.
study was verifying that particular fact. But so if the companies who are small, they don't have these digital tools or technological mediums which are not in line with the changes, so they are not going to survive. So for every now and then, if a proper market research is not being done to analyze the changes or in the behavior of the doctors, in the behavior of the consumers, or in the changes in everything, means what you can do with market research is something which I cannot answer in even 1 hour. You can do everything, means you can expand your business, you can grow your business, you can test your business, you can test your product, what communication you should develop, what how you should market this product, how you should position your product, how the patient journey should looks like. All this information comes from market research. So now market research is going to be far, far, far more important than any other particular field. So because I can't waste money, I as a company can't waste money. If I'm spending a single penny, I need to ensure that I'm spending the money in the right direction. And that direction can only come from right market research. So to your question in short, I can answer that market research is, there are a lot of companies coming in all their money is getting poured by the pharmaceutical companies on this particular subject. They want to, some of the companies want to develop the in-house market research capability. Some are outsourcing them, like GSK, they are outsourcing it to WNS, but Novartis, they are having it in the in-house. Dr. Reddy is having their in-house market research capabilities. So there are companies who were not doing it, but now doing it are going to develop these kind of capabilities in-house because the changing scenario is now needed.
Right, right, Pankaj. Pankaj, almost we have answered a lot of questions, but friends, due to the time constraint, if any question is remaining, please do mail your question on my email, saurabh@ihmr.edu.in, and I will get in touch with Pankaj and we'll try to. But more or less, we have answered all the questions. So with these words, you know, we come to the end of this webinar. But Pankaj, many, many thanks for sharing such a wonderful experience. It was a truly fantastic experience listening to you. And the case studies which you discussed, they were the real case studies which actually, you know, you went through when you were working in the organizations. So on behalf of School of Pharmaceutical Management, IHMR University, Jaipur, I once again thank you very much for your time, the pains you took for delivering this very informative information. And once again, many, many thanks for joining us. And thank you very much to the participants who joined us today for this particular webinar. We thank all the participants also for joining us. And thank you very much to all of you. Have a nice day. Have a great day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Saurabh sir. And I would like to thank all the participants who are patiently hearing.
Yes.
During my entire session, I would just like to request and stay safe, stay indoors whenever it's possible. COVID is still there. Probably the market is opening. Stay safe. Right. I would be happy to have this kind of conversation in physical presence, but sure. Times are such where we are not allowed or not safe to do that. So would love to see you in person sometime in future. So be healthy, stay safe, stay secure. Thank you.
Thank you, Pankaj. Thank you, all of you. Have a nice day.